Mr. President, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, as this council is aware, in November 2019, the people of Sri Lanka gave a resounding mandate to President Gotabaya Rajapaksa to pursue a policy framework aimed at achieving the fourfold outcome of a productive citizenry, a contented family, discipline, a just society, and a prosperous nation. It is envisaged to achieve sustainable development and peace in the country, firmly anchored in safeguarding national security without compromise in the democratic space available to the people. It was over a decade ago, on 18 May 2009, that Sri Lanka defeated LTT terrorism militarily, bringing to an end 3 decades of conflict and suffering. The end of the brutal conflict advanced, secured, protected one of the fundamental human rights, the right to life, for all Sri Lankans, Sinhalese, Tamil, Muslim, and others. I would like to state with pride that since May 2009, not a bullet has been fired in the name of separatist movement in Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka never had any illusion that the end of the conflict against LTT terrorists will overnight convert to lasting peace. Although Sri Lanka was not a case of nation building, like many other conflict situations that this council is dealing with, we were mindful that Sri Lanka needed certain reviews and strengthening of existing structures. As part of a sustainable peace and reconciliation program, the government led by the then President Mahinda Rajapaksa, of which the current President Gotabaya Rajapaksa was the Secretary of the Ministry of Defense, initiated a sustainable reconciliation process in Sri Lanka to bring about a healing peace building, taking due cognizance to the ground realities at that time. This was viewed as an incremental and inclusive process, as it had taken even better resourced countries several decades to address and achieve. Mr. President, as of December 2014, at the point of mind, the Rajapaksa government, of which I was a member, was concluding its term, we had made a considerable progress in demining, resettlement, return of land used by the security forces, reduction of military presence in the former conflict areas, rehabilitation, reintegration of ex-LTT combatants, including child soldiers, rapid infrastructure development, restoration of the right to franchise in the former conflict-affected areas, and the establishment of domestic mechanisms to address issues related to accountability, rule of law, and human rights. Notwithstanding these inclusive and locally designed measures undertaken, carrying along the people of Sri Lanka, a group of UNHRC members, failing to appreciate the GOSL endeavors in defeating terrorism and bringing about stability, humanitarian relief, and lasting peace through a carefully balanced reconciliation process, moved consecutive country-specific resolutions at the UNHRC on Sri Lanka in 2012, 13, and 14. Mr. President, the previous government in July 2015 jettisoned this homegrown reconciliation process, which was bearing fruit. In an unprecedented move in the annals of the Human Rights Council, and contrary to the Sri Lanka's stance on the country-specific resolutions, the government at that time co-sponsored UNHRC Resolution 30/1 on Sri Lanka. Substantively, the previous government noted with appreciation the much flawed OISL report, which was used as a basis not only for Resolution 31, but also to unjustify, vilify the heroic Sri Lanka's security forces, possibly the only national security establishment that defeated terrorism in that time. This was despite there being an abundance of evidence in the contrary, contained in, one, domestic reports such as the LLRC, Justice Paranagama Commission report, information presented before the UK House of Lords by Lord Nesby, challenging, among other things, the vastly exaggerated civilian figures, other reports of the UN, international agencies including the ICRC, as well as exposed diplomatic cables. Constitutionally, the resolution seeks to cast upon Sri Lanka obligations that cannot be carried out within its constitutional framework, and it infringes the sovereignty of people of Sri Lanka, violates the basic structure of our constitution. This is another factor that has prompted Sri Lanka to reconsider its position in co-sponsorship. Procedurally, in co-sponsoring Resolution 31, previous government violated all democratic principles of governance. It declared support for the resolution even before the draft text was presented. It sought no cabinet approval to bind the country to deliver the dictates of an international body. There was no reference to Parliament on the process, undertaking, and repercussions of such co-sponsorship. More importantly, the resolution itself included provisions which are undeliverable due to its inherent illegality, being in the violation of the Constitution, the supreme law of the country. It also overruled reservations expressed by professionals, diplomats, academia, media, and the general public. The then President Maithripala Sirisena also stated that he was not consulted on this matter. It remains to date a blot on the sovereignty and the dignity of the people of Sri Lanka. The commitments made bound the country to carry out this experiment, which was impractical, unconstitutional, and undeliverable, despite strong opposition and evidence that many of the undertakings couldn't be carried out merely to please a few countries. In terms of reputational damage, it eroded Sri Lanka's trust in the international system and the credibility of Sri Lanka as a whole in the eyes of the international community. This irresponsible action also damaged long-nurtured regional relationship, non-aligned, as well as the South Asian solidarity. The deliberate polarization it sought to cause through trade-off that resulted in Sri Lanka's foreign policy being reduced to a zero-sum game, made my country a pawn on the chessboard of global politics, and unnecessarily drew Sri Lanka away from its traditional neutrality. More seriously, it is seen that the dictated changes in the country pursuant to 30-1 undermine the national interest, compromise national security, including weakening national intelligence operations and related safeguards, which are deemed to have contributed to the lapses that resulted in Easter Sunday attacks in April 2019 in Sri Lanka, which targeted churches, hotels, resulting in loss of life, including those of foreign nationals, which poses challenges to our government to restore national security. It is ironic. In March 2019, the previous government, which co-sponsored Resolution 30-1 in October 2015, began the process of dismantling its dictates through the statement made in this council by my predecessor, which acknowledged the very real constraint that had ignored 4 years before the time of the co-sponsoring resolution. That statement sought to qualify the parameters of co-sponsorship of the resolution. It questioned the resolution 30-1 characterization of the nature of the conflict, estimated number of deaths, push back on the alleged culpability of the security forces, curtailed the effect of the security sector reform demanded, asserted that Sri Lanka Constitution precludes involvement of foreign judges and prosecutors in the judicial mechanism process. Notwithstanding this admission, the former government continued its co-sponsorship, which fully supported the operationalization of the resolution 30/1. With the election of President Gotabaya Rajapaksa, with an overwhelming majority, the people of Sri Lanka have given a clear signal for their wish for a different path forward for the country. As President Rajapaksa stated in his address at the 72nd commemoration of the Independence Day of Sri Lanka, we will always defend the right of every citizen to participate in political and governance processes through his or her elected representatives, unquote. According to the wishes of the people of Sri Lanka, while following a non-aligned, neutral foreign policy, our government is committed to examining issues afresh, to forge ahead with its agenda, prosperity through security and development, and to find a homegrown solutions to overcome contemporary challenges in the best interest of all Sri Lankans. It is in this context that I wish to place on record Sri Lanka's decision to withdraw from the co-sponsorship of the resolution 40/1 on promoting reconciliation, accountability and human rights in Sri Lanka, which also incorporates and builds on preceding resolutions 30/1 of October 2015 and 34/1 of March 2017. Mr. President, notwithstanding withdrawing from the co-sponsorship of this resolution, Sri Lanka remains committed to achieving the goals set by the people of Sri Lanka on accountability, human rights, towards sustainable peace and reconciliation. To this end, firstly, the government of Sri Lanka declares its commitment to achieve sustainable peace through an inclusive, domestically designed, executed reconciliation and accountability process, including through appropriate adoption of existing mechanisms in line with the government's policy framework. This would comprise the appointment of a commission of inquiry, which headed by a justice of the Supreme Court, to review the reports of the previous Sri Lanka commissions of inquiry, which investigated the alleged violations of human rights and international humanitarian law, to assess the status of implementation of their recommendations, and to propose deliverable measures to implement them, keeping in line with the new government's policy. Secondly, the government will also address other outstanding concerns and introduce institutional reforms where necessary in a manner consistent with Sri Lanka's commitments, including 2030 Sustainable Development Agenda. We will implement policies rooted in the government's commitment to the people by advancing individual and collective rights, protections under the law, ensuring justice and reconciliation, and addressing the concerns of the vulnerable sections of our society. A discussion has already been held between the President and the UN Resident Coordinator, where it has been agreed to connect the relevant UN agencies to help the government of Sri Lanka in the implementation of the SDGs. Thirdly, Sri Lanka will continue to remain engaged with and seek, as required, the assistance of the UN and its agencies, including the regular human rights mandates, bodies and mechanisms in capacity building and technical assistance, in keeping with domestic priorities and policies. Finally, In conjunction with all members of the UN, Sri Lanka will seek to work towards the closure of the resolution. Mr. President, no one has the well-being of multi-ethnic, multilingual, multi-religious, multicultural people of Sri Lanka closer to their heart than government of Sri Lanka. It is this motivation that guides our commitment and resolve to move towards comprehensive reconciliation and an era of stable peace and prosperity for our people. It is therefore our strong conviction that the aforementioned actions within the framework of Sri Lanka's domestic priorities and policies are not only realistic but also deliverable. We call upon the stakeholders within and outside this august body to cooperate with Sri Lanka in this endeavour. May I conclude, quoting the words of Lord Buddha, Siyalu Sattvayo Nidukvetva Nirogi Vetva Suapatveva. May all beings be safe. May all beings be free from suffering. May all beings be well and happy. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.